You're feeling nervous, aren't you, boy? With your quiet voice and impeccable style. Don't ever let them steal your joy and your gentle ways to keep them from running wild. They can kick dirt in your face, dress you down and tell you that your place is in the middle when they hate the way you shine. I see you tugging on your shirt, trying to hide inside of it and hide how much it hurts. Let 'em laugh while they can. Let 'em spin. Let 'em scatter. I've been to the movies, I've seen how it ends, and the jokes on them. You get discouraged, don't you, girl? It's your brother's world for a while longer. We gotta dance with the devil on a river to beat the stream. Call it living the dream. Call it kicking the ladder. They come to kick dirt in your face, to call you weak, and then displace you after carrying your baby on your back across the desert. I saw your eyes behind your hair, and you're looking tired, but you don't look scared.
Morning. Welcome. You are welcome here. As Joseph said, this day was made for you, and you are welcome here no matter who you are. We walk our own paths, some very different, but we gather here to center ourselves today, to light the fire within us, to recharge our weary souls. You are all full of love, light, and possibility. just like this day. Join us now as we celebrate. Please rise in body or spirit to sing hymn number 149, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Welcome to UUYO on this bleak midwinter's day. We're glad you're here. I am Sarah Lown, and this is Mindy Raley. And the two of us are tag teaming the service today because it takes two of us to fill Reverend Joseph's one shoe. So here we are. Just a couple brief announcements before we move on here. Today is the day of our annual meeting. Come on down. I'm promised it will only last 20 minutes, and there's food. What can be better? And there's childcare. On top of that, there's childcare. That alone, I think, is impetus to attend. So thank you. I look forward to seeing your faces downstairs in Channing Hall. after services. And then one last thing. We have a poetry night this coming Wednesday, January 25th, 7 p.m., Schweitzer Hall, right here, downstairs. Come with your favorite poem. We will share poems. Maybe we'll have a mashup of poems. There's no end to the happiness that can go on. So please attend that if you will. Thank you. And now, please turn to your great big jumbotron in the front, and Melissa will do our chalice lighting.
Okay, I hope I'm unmuted. I can't read my screen.
You're good, Melissa.
Okay, thanks. I'm here to light our chalice in order to center and recenter ourselves on the 50th anniversary of the Roe v. Wade decision. Slightly more than 2 years ago, I embarked on a candidacy in commissioned lay ministry. And I was motivated as a means of centering myself in the Youngstown community and in a faith community. And post my retirement from the YSU Foreign Languages Department, with Russian language and culture as my focus, I laid my travels aside and began centering myself within and traveling to destinations within and within reach. One of my first efforts in the years in the 2 years, practically to the day, was to deliver a sermon commemorating the Supreme Court decision of January 22nd, 1922. It's fitting that we have this commemoration today, since we're discussing women's issues with Sarah and Mindy, and I can't read my writing. In this post-Wade world, what does it mean to say our bodies, ourselves? Since the Supreme Court decision, the feminist slogan, "the personal is political," has taken on a myriad of new meanings. So we light our chalice today in the hopes of reframing these questions beyond the personal and political.
This is Liam. He's going to help me with the story today. So this is Dear Girl by Amy Krauss Rosenthal. Turn it again. Here we go. Keep that arm raised. You have smart things to say. Dear Girl, sometimes you may feel like being pink and sparkly. Sometimes you may feel pretty much the opposite. Dear girl, look at yourself in the mirror. Say thank you to something that makes you you. Thank you, red hair. Dear girl, sometimes you just need a good cry. Sometimes you'll need a friend. Sometimes you'll need to be alone. Sometimes you'll need a
tissue.
Sometimes you'll need a bucket. Turn the page. There you go. Dear girl, do you know that there is such a thing as asking too many questions? Who, what, where, when, why, how? Dear girl, write down your thoughts once in a while, even if it's just to enjoy the way your pen feels against the paper. Dear girl, make your room awesome. Make your room you. And while you're at it, make your bed. Dear girl, don't ever lose your sense of wonder. Dear girl, sometimes you've just got to stop and dance. Dear girl, find people like you. Find people unlike you. Dear girl, create traditions. Fun, crazy handshakes and silly inside jokes. Oh, you skipped a page. There you go. Dear girl, if your instinct is telling you to say no, you know. Dear girl, coloring outside the lines is cool too. Dear girl, there are no rules about what to wear or how to cut your hair. Dear girl, you know what's really boring? When people say how they are bored. Dear girl, listen to your brave side. Dear girl, you won't be invited to every single party on the planet, which is really okay. Can you imagine how exhausting that would be? Dear girl, a tree trunk is like the perfect place for quiet thoughts to be thunk. Dear girl, whenever you need an encouraging boost, remember you can't turn to any page in this book. You can turn to any page in this book. Most of all, dear girl, who I love, know that you can always, always, always turn to me. The end. It's time to go to class, and parents, don't forget there is childcare after the service for the meeting.
Please join me in reading the covenant of our church, which can be found in your order of service. Love is the spirit of this church and service its law. This is our great covenant, to seek one another in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
Our seventh principle calls on us to respect the interdependent web of existence of which we are a part, including nurturing and supporting non-human beings. For January, we will honor this commitment by supporting an organization that is founded to promote responsible pet ownership and assist pet owners care for their beloved companions. The Bummer Fund assists those who have a record for providing a good home for a pet, but whose current incomes do not permit some necessary medical care for their pet. The fund gives priority to seniors on fixed income or families experiencing limited funds due to chronic illness, for whom the loss of a pet would be harmful, and in other urgent cases similar to that. And for more information, go right into Facebook and look for the Bummer Fund. Press like, press follow. And now, will the ushers please come forward and we receive the offering that sustains the activities of this church and the community. Thank you.
The dish and drain, the soap and sink, the cup and plate, the warm wool socks and the cold white tile, shower heads and good dry towels, and frying eggs sound like psalms with bits of salt measured in my palm. It's all a part of a sacrament as holy as a day is spent. Holy is the busy street and cars that boom with passion's beat, and the checkout girl counting change, hands that shook my hand today, and hymns of peace fly overhead, spread their wings like their parents did. Blessed be the dog who runs in her sleep to chase some wild elusive thing. Holy is the familiar room and quiet moments in the afternoon, folding sheets like folding hands to pray as only laundry can. I'm letting go of all my fear like autumn leaves made of earth and air, for summer and summer went as holy as a day is spent. Holy is the place I stand to do whatever good I can in the empty page and the open book. Redemption everywhere I look. Unknowingly we sow our pace in the shade of unexpected grace, and with grateful smiles and sad lament, as holy as a day is spent. As holy as a day is spent.
I invite you now to join me in a moment of silent meditation with a little bit of guided reflection as you sit in silence with your eyes relaxed or closed. I want you to focus on your center, what centers you. Our first reading comes from Galatians 3, 27 to 28. For all those of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ.
With her chalice lighting, Melissa Smith marked this, the anniversary of the Roe decision made 50 years ago today. With the Supreme Court's recent reversal in Dobbs, we spiral full circle on that question. How much do our bodies really belong to ourselves? Last week, Reverend Joseph referred to the days on the mountain to echo Martin Luther King, and he added to that those equally important days in the wilderness. That is certainly an apt metaphor to ruminate on our 50-year-long journey. When I turn my mind to gender and issues related to gender, I find myself spinning around like a little tin-headed top. I feel inadequate to the task. I stand too close to that looking glass to see anything clearly. In my world, I see women marginalized in many settings. Just the other day, I looked on as a male counterpart praised a female colleague of mine for moving a table. And he said it in this tone, such a strong woman, he quips. And she turns to him and says, it's only a card table. And then we got a little chuckle out of the whole thing. And later, we talked about it and then said, there should be a word for those little exchanges. What are they? Micro condescensions, micro derision, mini minimizing. I don't know, minimize sounds like a slimming undergarment. But there is no word, that's it. There's no word, but you know it when you see it. So much water under the bridge since the Roe decision. Back then, women walked out of the church en masse. Our bodies, ourselves got published. The Equal Rights Amendment was getting adopted state by state. Meanwhile, back in my state, in New Hampshire, in my hometown, ratifying the ERA was all the talk. And I'll never forget our old neighbor, Bill Eastler. Bill Eastler drove a late model Buick sedan with a bumper sticker on the back that read, "A nuclear power plant is built better than Jane Fonda's body." Bill turned to 10-year-old me and told me I was clueless. He said, women have had all the power all along. Your problem is you just don't know it, he said. But everything we men do, everything we do, is done for the women. And the other men were circled around, and as if this were call and response at the local Baptist church, they're going, amen, brother. And that was that. Those were the times, you know. And meanwhile, the constant drumbeat going back 2,000 and more years has been just this. Women should keep silent, should be subordinate, should be submissive. These were all pulled straight from the letters of Paul in the New Testament. Paul might have said, we are all equal in Christ, but he saw that there was no way to build Christendom. And if we were to line up all the scriptures on that back wall there, just paste them all up against that wall, and we're talking scriptures from nearly every ancient source. And if we were to play pin the tail on the donkey with a blindfold, 9 times out of 10, your donkey tail would hit a passage that casts women in a negative light. It's just how it is. Then to heap it on a bit more, Right now, there is someone in a pulpit, right here in Youngstown. There's someone standing in the pulpit saying the same things Paul said. And I know this because come Monday morning, I'll get to hear all about it. And it's chilling. Of course, feminist scholarship surmises that all religion was devised from a male pathos known as womb envy. The male resentment toward women's power to give life led men to manufacture a male god and say that that male god is really the guy who controls life, death, and everything in between. And furthermore, only men can be ambassadors to that male god in order to get you to the great beyond. Nice, clean racket. We don't know, no one knows, but so it goes. We might take comfort in what Reverend Joseph was talking about last week with Reverend Martin Luther King's words. The arc of history is long, but it bends towards justice. Well, good. But what does justice look like when it comes to gender? Is it a balance of power? Is it a redistribution of goods? Is it clearing out of their bank accounts? Anyone raising a family knows there's minefields all over the place when it comes to justice in a family. Would it be better if the arc of history simply bent up toward the skies in a wide, radiant rainbow arc? This would be the arc that lifts us all up, the lowly and the lucky and everyone in between. Perhaps justice and the whole notion of justice is too transactional. And maybe what we're talking about is lifting each other up through love, the kind of love we talk about in our covenant, the love that inspires service, that promotes peace, and issues that desire to help one another. Over Christmas, I'm talking to a friend, and she asked me, what would it look like to live in love for fellow humanity? You know, just all of the time. And without hesitating, I said, oh, of course, it'd be like Scrooge after the ghosts got to him. You know, he's got Tiny Tim on one shoulder and the prize turkey on the other. He's walking around, you know, and then later I'm thinking, oh my God, the fairy dust in my mind blows it out. And I'm thinking, well, what does it look like to live in love? And I'm thinking, it's much simpler than that, really. And there is no fairy dust. There's little love letters hidden in plain sight all around us, quietly waiting to be found. It's in today's chalice lighting. It's in Kathleen's story. It's in the wonderful music from Jeff and Tina and Jennifer. It's in the time we have together, shameless plug here, at the annual meeting downstairs. A little later on. Love comes in the stories of our lives, the bad and the good. Love comes with the laughter. Love comes with the tales told on the big silver screen and in tiny verses. Love comes when you're drawn in by a fluttering oak leaf or by a flittering bird on a bleak midwinter's morning. Love comes to you every time you say please and every time you say thank you. That's the source of our power. And it sits right at the heart, the center of you and me. And I think that's lovely.
tell you something about my life. Maybe give me insight between black and white. And the best thing you've ever done for me is to help me take my life less seriously. It's only life after all. Yeah. Well, darkness has a hunger that's insatiable. And lightness has a call that's hard to hear. I wrap my fear around me like a blanket. I sail my ship of safety till I sink it. I'm crawling on your shore. I went to the doctor. I went to the mountains. I looked to the children. I drank from the fountains. There's more than one answer to these questions, pointing me in a crooked line. And the less I see myself, the closer I am to find. Closer I am to find. I went to see the doctor of philosophy. With a poster of Rasputin and a beard down to his knee. Never did Mary or see the great movie. He graded my performance. He said he could see through me. I spent 4 years prostrate to the higher mind. Got my papers and I was free. I went to the doctor. I went to the mountains. I looked to the children, I drank from the fountains. There's more than one answer to these questions, pointing me in a crooked line. And the less I see my source for some definitive, closer I am to find. The closer I am to find.
A friend, and I woke up with a headache like my head against a board, twice as cloudy as I'd been the night before, and I went in seeking clarity. I went to the doctor, I went to the mountains, I looked to the children, I drank from the fountains. We go to the doctor, we go to the mountains. We look to the children. We drink from the fountains. We go to the Bible. We go through the workout. We read up on revival. We stand up for the lookout.
There's more than one answer to these questions, pointing me in a crooked line.
And the less I see my source for something definitive,
the closer I am to find. The closer I am to find. The closer I am to find.
Okay, and now to send the good cheer right back down on the tanker, I'm going to read a poem for you for our second reading called Fearful Women by Carolyn Keyser. Arms and the girl I sing, oh, rare arms that are braceleted and white and bare. Arms that were lovely Helen's, in whose name Greek slaughtered Trojan, and Helen was to blame. Mythologize your women. none escape. Europe was named from an act of bestial rape. Eponymous girl on bullback, he intent on scattering sperm across the continent. Old Zeus refused to take the rap. It's not his name in big print on the map. But let's go back to the beginning, when sinners didn't know that they were sinning. He, one rib short, she lived to rue it, when Adam said to God, "She made me do it." Eve learned that learning was a dangerous thing for her. No end of trouble would it bring. An educated woman is a danger. Lock up your mate. Keep a submissive stranger. Like Darby's Joan, content with church and kinder. Not like sainted Joan, who got burnt to a cinder. Whether we wield a scepter or a mop, it's clear you fear that we may get on top. And if we do, I say without malice, it's not from you we learn to be magnanimous.
I always feel so tall when I'm up here. I picked that poem Sarah chose to read. My child said it was too controversial. What's the point of being UU if you can't be controversial? I am woman, hear me roar. I wish I could say I came into this world roaring and I'll go out that way too. But the truth is, I was born holding my breath, literally, not breathing. And who knows how I'll die? Preferably in my sleep, in a big comfy bed, as a millionaire. But who knows? All I can say is that in between birth and death, I will roar. A lot of people think that I am nice and sweet. Some people think that I'm quiet. In my job, I spend a lot of time on the phone talking to strangers, and in my customer service voice, I sound young. So they assume that I'm young, maybe inexperienced, and for some reason, a lot of people think when they talk to me on the phone that I'm blonde. I don't know. I laugh because none of those things are true, and yet all of those things maybe are a little true. I can be quiet in moments of reflection, meditation, or when I'm anxious and uncomfortable, like around new people, I tend to be quiet. But most of the time, I am loud. I roar, especially like later today when my Cincinnati Bengals are playing on TV. Loud. I am my mother's warrior daughter. I am a fierce fighter, and I fight like a mother. If you stand with me, I will strive to protect you from all the world. But if you stand against me, I show no mercy. Don't get me wrong, I am a nice person, and I try to be a good person. I have the grace of a goddess when I so choose, but I also have the temper of a goddess as well. We women, all of us, underestimated and overlooked at times. But the truly wise know that we are all of us, goddesses at heart, whether we realize that for ourselves or not. For thousands and thousands of years, people worshiped goddesses. From the beginning of recorded history, goddesses and gods were both worshiped alike, as people realized that it takes both man and woman to create life, both masculine and feminine, to create balance. And we all have some level of each within us. Some archaeologists and historians speculate that the very earliest forms of religion, predating recorded history, were matriarchal, where the only, or at least the main deity was female. There are idols that have been found thousands and thousands of years old of women who were worshipped. Early people recognized that women have a capacity to love and also to destroy beyond what is usually accepted in today's society. From the ancient Incas to Greeks, Romans, Vikings, pagans, Hindus, Buddhists, all these religions recognize the sacred feminine. And not only are there many goddesses that have been worshipped, but most of these goddesses are powerful. Of course, you would expect a goddess of fertility and a goddess of love, because that's what women are for. But there's also the goddess of wisdom, the goddess of war, the goddess of heaven and hell, the goddess of protection, of fire and fighting, because women are about more than just fertility. Women are more than just a vessel to carry a baby to life. That is one of our ultimate powers, but it's not our only power. These goddesses were both loved and feared, worshipped and revered. That is, until some men began to fear the power of women and try to suppress us. Along the way, goddess worship somehow became hippy-dippy nonsense, and God became one singular male deity, like it is in most modern religion. Because when something is too powerful, you fear it, and if you fear it, you have to control it. At least that's what some people think. A wise person recognizes that a truly strong woman will never be controlled unless it's by her own will. In nature, there's balance. Men are physically stronger than women, but women have more physical endurance. How many men do you know who could survive 18 hours of labor? Yeah. Men tend to be larger with stronger bones, but women live longer and tend to recover better from illness. I believe there's no such thing as a fairer sex. Men and women, we were made to complement each other and complete each other. And as I say that, I recognize that there are more than just men and women. Gender and sex is a wide-ranging thing. But at the same time, within each of us is masculine and feminine. We are all pieces of each other. I am a woman who does not feel that I am better than any man, but I also damn well know I'm not less than any man either. In the 70s, there was "I Am Woman, Hear Me Roar." In the late 90s and early 2000s, everything was "Fight Like a Girl." Today, the thing seems to be girl power, which is both uplifting and insulting all at once. Because while it is without question that women have power, somehow the phrase girl power just doesn't seem to have the same fight to it. My favorite expression, honestly, is "fight like a mother," because there is no stronger force on earth than a mother fighting. Still, I say, "I am woman, hear me roar," because I'm a 70s baby. When Sarah and I were discussing this service, and she said she was going to talk about the Christian aspect and beat the drum, and then I was going to talk about earth religion, the goddess aspect, and be uplifting and positive, I agreed. And then I started working on this. 50 years ago, the Supreme Court passed Roe v. Wade. Last year, the Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade. So on this day, I think it's important to talk about the fact that women are more than just a vessel, that we are more than just a body, and the decision whether or not to use that body to bring a new life into this world is a personal decision and should not be made by anyone, ultimately, other than that woman. I was supposed to be the love and light, hippy-dippy goddess, uplifting part of the service, And I'm sorry to say that I think I failed, because I am angry with the anger of a goddess. I am angry, and I'm sorry that I can't pretend not to be. As much as my heart is filled with love and light, and it is, it really is, it's also filled with anger. I will not stand by as my rights and the rights of other women are stripped away. I will not consent. I will not be silent. I will roar. And I invite you to roar with me. I'll close by sharing two quotes. One is a direct quote from Martin Luther King Jr. that says, "Our lives." I almost always cry when I read this quote. "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter." The other is a paraphrase, because the way it was written for men. So I paraphrase Edmund Burke. "Evil succeeds when good people do nothing." So you have the choice to do nothing, or you have the choice to roar. I choose to roar, and I invite you all to roar with me. In lieu of the prayer today, I'm going to read a poem. May you be well. May you be cleansed and purified of all that isn't health. May every cell in your body wake up and fight. May the powerful light of healing move into every part of you. May you return to being purely you. May you be well.
And now please turn to hymn number 401 in your gray hymnal, Kumbaya.
This is a song I bet all of you know. You're going to channel your old sitting by a campfire days. How many of you sat by a campfire and sang Kumbaya when you were younger? Sure. It's a wonderful old African song, and in the spirit of its the translation of it, "Come by here," I think it's very appropriate.
Extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth.
the warmth of community or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. And as you go in and as you go out, and as you go around town and as you sit by yourself, please remember the one great fact. You are loved and never truly alone.
Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver wings. Life's a twinkling, that's for certain, but it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits, there's a festival of friends, and we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again. And thank you to Jennifer, and thank you to Tina for being with us.